Okay. All right. Thank you, everyone, for joining us this Friday afternoon. We are in for a real treat. Our very special NYU professor, colleague from the psychology department, Jay Van Bavel, who is joining us to talk about his research and the most recent book that he wrote with a colleague of his. I, without further ado, I want to see Jay's video here, and maybe have a conversation about what you found out in your long research that you've done for quite some time. The book is just the outcome of many, many years of looking into these issues, right? And I love the cover of it. Jay, maybe you say the most important things about yourself, because your bio is so long, your publication list is so long, and you are one of the most popular psychology professors I know at NYU and another school. But why don't we get started right away? You're on mute right now, so.
Great, thanks, Anna. Thanks everyone for having me and joining me this afternoon. I'm just gonna get my screen shared here so you can see. I prepared about 25 minutes to 30 minutes of slides. And just let me know if you can see them, Anna.
Yeah, it's perfect. And so Jay, after you talk and give a little intro into yourself, we did share your bio and some of the podcasts you've done. But I think it would be great to hear first how you got here to this book and your research, and then we will have Q&A at the end. That's the fun part of this presentation. Thank you.
Thank you. Yeah. So my name is Jay Van Bavel. I'm an associate professor of psychology at NYU and primarily appointed in psychology, but also neuroscience. So I'm a social neuroscientist by training. And I have an appointment, a cross appointment at the Stern Business School in management and organizations. And so my research really bridges the psychology and neuroscience of how people make group-based and collective decisions. And so for the last few years, I've been working with my co-author and good friend, Dominic Packer, to try to put this into a trade book so that anybody who's interested in these issues can read it. Our goal is to give people the tools to become smarter about groups, and also give them the tools to make smarter groups. And so we want people to have deeper insight into many of these issues. And the reason we want to do this is because we realize that there are so many myths floating around in the media and the popular press about how people behave. And we wanted to basically bust a bunch of those myths and allow people to understand how groups influence them, but also to give them the tools so they could influence groups. Whether you're like coaching your daughter's soccer team or a CEO of a major organization, understanding how groups work is fundamental to your success in any of those lines of work. So without further ado, let me show you some of the just couple key findings and key points from the book. Obviously, this is just going to scratch the surface. It's the tip of the iceberg. So if you like these ideas and you find them useful and interesting, I encourage you to check out the book. And as well, certainly ask questions after the talk. The main theme of our book and one of the core ideas that we want to communicate is that we all contain multitudes. And what this means is that each of us, everybody on this call, and certainly myself, contain different identities. And what identity is important to us in a given moment matters based on our context. So right now I'm speaking to you as an author, which is a brand new identity I have, and it's changed who I interact with and how I think about the world. My day job is a professor, but as soon as this call's over, I'm a dad. I have to go home to my kids and get dinner ready. I'm also a Canadian. So, when the Olympics are on, I have a totally different identity that's at the front of my mind. And all of us are like this. We have all of these identities floating around. And what's important to us at a given moment shapes how we think about the world, how we smell things, how we taste things, and some of our research has found, all the way up to like how we decide to dissent if we're in a group that's going wrong, or what types of leaders are appealing to us, and how you can motivate people to make change. And so understanding identity is really key for all of these things. Our book shatters a lot of myths. I'm just gonna show you a few of those today and mention a few of them. The first one is that people have this notion that we are intrinsically self-interested. And this myth has been around for hundreds of years. Philosophers have been talking about this for a long time. The famous quote is that, you know, life is nasty, brutish, and short, in part because we're all just like fighting against one another to get our own. I'm going to tell you that that's not true. And what our book communicates is that even the most self-interested people can actually become interested in terms of their group when that identity is activated. When they're thinking about the self at a more collective and broader level, they become motivated and intrinsically interested in helping the group. And so I'm going to show you a piece of data on that. Another myth, this is a popular one right now, it's certainly in a lot of political discourse, is that groups are naturally tribal. And so the moment you're part of a group, your motivation is to discriminate against other groups. Well, it turns out that that's also a myth. And there's lots of research that shows that not to be true. So if you're in a group and the social norms of the group are ones that are inclusive, then you're more likely to embrace other people and engage with people who are different than you. And the more you identify with the group, the more you do that. And if you join a group that is tribal into one that is actually inclusive, your behavior will switch. And so this is another myth that needs to be debunked. Another one that we talk about a lot, when people think about groups, one thing that often comes to mind is like the issue of groupthink, that when we are all together, it can lead us to bad decisions because we just like follow what the leader says. Well, it turns out that the research on that is actually more complex. And it turns out, for example, that it turns out tight-knit groups sometimes are actually the most robust against groupthink, in part because they have what's called psychological safety, that they trust one another so much that they can confront each other, challenge ideas, present radical new perspectives, break down the status quo, and so forth. And so a lot of the ways we think about how to reduce groupthink, it turns out, are actually wrong. And then a fourth myth I'm just going to mention briefly is that there's a belief that people are inherently conformists, that we're like lemmings or sheeple. And it turns out that that's wrong. So we also discuss some of the most famous studies in the history of social psychology, where people conform in great numbers or obey, you know, malevolent authorities. And what we find is in many of those studies, people are actually resisting. And it turns out that what's driving the conformity or obedience actually turns out to be leadership that's happening outside of the scenes that you're not seeing if you're reading the papers, or if you remember these from like your introduction to these issues, or if you've read other popular trade books. We reanalyze those given current thinking and current analyses and suggest that actually they tell a very different story. And so these are just some of the myths that need to be busted in society, but we try to start to get the conversation and change it in a new direction in our book. So I'm gonna give you, get you thinking. So right now, if you saw, you know, you're walking to a meeting later today after this gets off or going home, and you're walking behind this fellow and he falls down in pain. You know, he rolls his ankle and falls down and it's clear that he's injured. How many of you think you would help him? So you could just like enter it in the chat if you think you would help him. Most people say they would help, but what happens in these actual studies, it turns out that it matters a lot who this person is. And what their relationship to you is. And so I'm just going to communicate this to you before I show you the study on this. It's that all of us have a moral circle. And what this means is that these are the boundaries that determine who is deserving of our concern, who we're going to help and who we're not going to help. And it turns out that for many of us, we assume we have a broad moral circle, but in reality, our moral circles tend to be reasonably narrow. It's often our immediate family, some friends, maybe some colleagues who we really love, maybe not some other colleagues. And what is required for us to expand our moral circle is to rethink who we are in terms of our identity, to understand that these other people outside our immediate moral circle share an identity with us. So let me show you one of my favorite studies on this. This was actually done in England, and they had soccer fans. So these are, you know, a picture of your typical image of your stereotype of soccer fans. And they looked at fans in this rivalry. And so this is very much like the Boston Red Sox and New York Yankees. That's how the Manchester United fans feel about fans from Liverpool. And so in this case, a Manchester United fan would be walking. First, they were asked, reminded about how much they loved their team. And then they were asked, told to walk to another building. As they were walking to another building, they saw that stranger that I showed you a photo of before trip in front of them. But what they manipulated by basically just a flip of a coin is whether the person who was in pain was wearing either a Manchester jersey, a Liverpool jersey, or a plain shirt. So think for a second now, if you'd help somebody who was, you know, a fan of your favorite team or from your home country, or if you wouldn't, if they were wearing a fan of an opposing team. Well, what they found is that these participants, when their identity as a Manchester fan was activated, they helped the person wearing the Manchester jersey 92% of the time. So almost every single time, every single participant would help a fellow fan from the same team. And when they saw somebody wearing a Liverpool jersey, they only helped them a third of the time, so 30%. And if they saw just somebody wearing a plain shirt, they also helped them only 33% of the time. So this gives you a sense of the moral circle of these fans, right? That it's very narrow. It includes maybe family, some close friends, and also fellow Manchester's fans. But it doesn't really include anybody outside that, whether they're an outgroup member or just somebody in a plain shirt. Okay, now you take these same fans, they ran a second study also with Manchester fans, and they changed one key feature of the study. They activated their identities as soccer fans. So not just Manchester fans, but they wanted them to think about what they love about soccer in general and what how great it is to be a soccer fan, all the great things about like going to the game and cheering on your favorite sport. And when they did that, these exact same Manchester United fans were equally willing to help both Liverpool fans and Manchester fans. Although admittedly, not the person in the plain shirt, right? Because that person was not a fan of a team. And so what this means is that they were able to expand their moral circles of the exact same group of people. And this means that Manchester fans are not callous or cold. It turns out that they just have different identities. And when their narrow identities as Manchester fans are activated, they're only willing to help Manchester fans, but they're capable of something more expansive. They have this other identity within them that's broader that includes all soccer fans. And the moment that you trigger that in a pretty simple way, their behavior in the real world to real people in distress that they don't know changes pretty dramatically. And so this suggests that our identity determines our moral circle. And not only that, that our identities are flexible and we can make them broader to help other people. So this gives us a sense of like, who do we help? We help people who are part of us. And how we define us is flexible and fluid. We contain multitudes, right? Now, you might be thinking, well, this is fine. These were just a kind of a random sampling of fans. But, you know, I work with some people who are really selfish and they don't really help anybody. They're always out for themselves. There's these self-interested people. Well, there's a study on that too. And this was a study actually run in the Netherlands. And they identified, they brought in people who were either pro-social. So these are people who just tend to help other people in general, or selfish. And then they asked, they were randomly assigned to receive either an individual identity activation to think about themselves as an individual, or to think about themselves as part of a bigger group of university students. And then they asked them how much they would contribute to a group of other students at their university. And what they found is that those people who are just intrinsically pro-social did exactly as you'd expect, right? These people contributed to the group 90% of the time, no matter what identity was activated, if you got them to think about themselves as part of this group of this university or just as an individual, they helped everybody. So these are like your Mother Teresa's. These are the people who are consistently contributing and helping others. What was more interesting though was when they looked at the selfish people. So when the selfish people had their individual identity activated, they only contributed to the group 44% of the time. So this is like that person you know at work, who really doesn't help out on group projects unless they actually absolutely have to. And they always like are selfishly hoarding resources or aiming for that corner office, and they have sharp elbows. But it turns out that if you take these exact same selfish people and you randomly give them a condition where you activate their social identity, in this study it was fellow university students, their cooperation nearly doubled from 44% to 79%. So now they look almost identical to pro-social people. And the reason for this is their identity, what they care about, might be themselves most of the time. But when you change their identity to be part of something broader, a collective, they think of themselves very differently and the other people around them. And suddenly those people are part of the self. And so it really requires you to rethink what the self is. But once you understand it, it changes the way that you think about how you might deal with somebody who's selfish and what you might do to motivate them to transform their sense of individual self to group self. Because this can radically change the way that they treat other people. In this case, it doubled cooperation. Once people have a sense of self, it also changes how they feel when other people on their team are successful. So I'm gonna give you an example. I actually completed, Anna asked me to give you more of my bio. So I did my PhD at the University of Toronto, which had one of the worst sports teams, especially the football team in the entire country. And then I did a postdoc at Ohio State University. And Ohio State University was amazing for two reasons. The first reason is it has the best social psychology program in the country, which is why I went there. But they also have one of the best college football teams in the country. So they've had the best, actually I looked over the last 12 or 13 years, they've had the second best team in the entire country for college football. And this is what a game looks like. You get 110,000 people in the fans dressed in scarlet and gray, cheering them on, which was mind blowing to me. I'd never seen anything like this for a college football team. What they found is that when a famous study by Robert Cialdini, he's a very famous social psychologist, wrote a book on influence. You should read it if you have a chance. One of his most famous studies was actually on group identity. And he found that when teams won on the weekend, when he went into the classroom on Monday, they started signaling their team identification. They wore t-shirts, hats with the team logo. And this wasn't just at Ohio State. He found this in many other universities where he had collaborators who went into the classrooms and looked at what students were wearing after wins and losses. The other thing that happened is students started to use the term we when they were describing a victory twice as often as they did after when describing a loss. So when your team is doing well, you start to think of yourself as part of the team. You refer to them as we. When your team, favorite team, didn't do very well, you describe them as them. Oh, those football players lost. The football team lost. That's not me. But if they win, you suddenly see yourself as part of them, even if you didn't go to the game, even if you never touched the field, even if you were at home watching. So it radically, success in group radically transforms how you think about your sense of identity. And you start to bask in their reflected glory. When they do well, you start to signal identification with the team. You start to signal that you're part of the team to other people, including strangers. And we've run studies following up on this at NYU. So this is an example of our neuroimaging center. So one of the reasons that we do this is we want to look kind of like a mechanic. If your car has problems, you want to look underneath the hood. We put people in an fMRI scanner, as you can see here, and we can show them images of their team or another team. And then we can give them money rewards and see how their brain responds when their team gets something versus the other team gets something versus when they get something. And I'm going to show you, this is an activation pattern of what's called the reward system. So it includes the nucleus accumbens, a part of the brain that triggers whenever we get something good. So whatever your favorite food is or drink, you know, if you're going out tonight, it's a Friday night, you're going to have your little reward system hopefully triggering most of the night. You get this basic dopamine hit in this part of the brain. Well, what we found is that people who care about the in-group not only give more money to their other members of their in-group, but when their in-group wins money, it activates this pattern of the reward system that gets activated as if they won money. And so you can think of this if you're driving, you know, this weekend and you look and you see these people like talking about their kid is on the honor roll. Well, they're signaling to the world and basking in their kid's success. They feel a reward that their kid is on the honor roll. Or a lot of people will like have a sticker from their alma mater if they're really proud of it, the university they went to. And they feel good when that team or that university does well, or when it moves up in the US News and World Rankings, that status in the academic world, they feel excited about that and they want to share it and announce it. And so what happens when you have a great sense of identity with the group is when other group members succeed, you feel part of that success. If you've ever been part of a great team at work or in sports or in life, you get genuine joy. And in fact, you can measure it in the brain, reward signals when someone on the team does well, as if when you did well. And so we can see this happening in the brain in real time, even though people might not be aware of it. And so one of the questions then is, what can you do to make people have these more inclusive identities, to want to help other people, to turn selfish people into selfless people and great cooperators, so that they all take joy in each other's successes rather than being competitive. And I'm going to show you, this is the most famous picture, one of the most famous pictures of all time. It's called, does anybody know what this is? I wish there was a chat open. I just see the Q&A. It's called Earthrise. And this was taken on the Apollo mission from the moon looking at the Earth. And at the time, it was a profound photo that really changed, you know, how people thought about the Earth to see it from this perspective is something almost no one in history had ever seen it before. Well, there was a great study where they brought in every astronaut who'd ever been up in space and looked down on the Earth, or as many as they could. And they asked them, how did this feel? And how has this changed you to see the Earth from above? And what almost every person said is that it triggered a profound sense of awe in them, but also a connection towards all of humanity. They no longer felt like members of their country, even though that's often who sent them up into outer space or to the moon. They felt like a global citizen, like something in them had broadened and changed. And so as one astronaut put it, when you go around the Earth in an hour and a half, you begin to recognize that your identity is with that whole thing. And so I'm not going to suggest that we send everybody to the moon. Unfortunately, that's not feasible or remotely affordable. But it does suggest that there are ways that you can profoundly change how people identify. And these astronauts said this affected them for the rest of their life. They no longer see themselves in the same way many of us might see ourselves as having very narrow identities. They have an incredibly broad one after this experience. It's a life-changing thing. So we all know these astronauts, of course. And so what can you do to motivate people in different organizations to care about the whole thing? And one of the best examples I saw of that was when I gave a talk at the Canadian Space Agency. So this is, you know, NASA, but in Canada, essentially. This is, they're famous for the space arm here. If you want to take a look at it, they put Canada on it. So if you have a camera in outer space, you can see it. So signaling their national identity all the way up there. Anyways, when you walk into the Canadian Space Agency, which is an incredibly beautiful building full of brilliant, committed people, you see a wall of all the astronauts who Canada has sent in space. And these people are famous. You know, they're in the front page of the news. They have book deals. Chris Hadfield is a famous astronaut. I noticed yesterday he was promoting his new book. These people are very successful in life. They become famous. But they have another wall. As I walked through and got a tour of the whole space station, they have another wall that's a list of unsung heroes. And so these are people in the organization who are working, you know, night and day to make a mission launch a success. These are people who don't get on the front page of the newspaper, don't get, you know, onto TV or movies or book deals. These are people who are often the most essential elements of success. So essential that everybody else working around them on the ground knows how critical they are to making it the launch and the mission a success. And there's a great book and great movie on this. It was based on Margalee Shetterly's Hidden Figures, which talked about these women, Black women, in NASA who were really essential to getting on the moon. They were computers at the time. They actually did the computations before we had active physical computers to do the work. So incredibly important, painstaking, precision-based work that was absolutely necessary for a safe moon landing. Now, these are the people, and every organization has them, and people on the ground working often know who they are. But one of the things I loved about the Canadian Space Agency is they found a way of recognizing them that was almost parallel to how they treated the astronauts. And so everybody often knows who the superstars are, but they wanted to signal, we care about people who are critical to our collective success, even if they're not famous or known to the public. And we're gonna know them internally. And so that was a really cool way of giving public recognition and status to people who made the group success critical and central to what they did. So how do you get people on the same wavelength like this? Obviously, this is all like very high level space station missions, obviously strategies that they've used in space agencies. But we've done something much more simple in my lab. And this is something that could be scaled in all kinds of organizations. And so this was a study led by my PhD student, Diego Renero. And we brought in groups of four people and had them perform a bunch of difficult tasks. And they were, by a flip of a coin, each group was either assigned to do it collectively and work together. So they all listened to the same music as they worked, you know, tapping exercise to get them on the same page. And they created a team name about who they were, what their identity was as a group. And they also worked for rewards. And so they were competing against other groups to get money. Or they did it as individuals, which is how much work occurs, right? They worked alone. They faced away from the other people in their group. They listened to the same music, but in their own headphones, so they couldn't tell they were all listening to the same thing. And they were told they were competing against other individuals. So they were competing against everybody around them. And this is how most Fortune 500 companies incentivize individual work, right? Which is mostly it's about individual success, promotion, and so forth. And then we had EEG caps on every person. And so we could measure their brain activity, again, to see what was going on that they might not have been aware of, you know, underneath the hood. And what we found is that teams outperformed individuals, collections of individuals on almost every task. And they cooperated more. They were willing to give more money after to fellow members of their team to have it doubled and then shared. And so everybody in the team's condition walked away on average with way more money because they're more successful at doing this. The other thing we found is that they were better at collective and innovative problem solving. So we had a measure of what's called collective intelligence. And teams vastly outperformed individuals on almost every single task. And then the other thing, and this was maybe the most interesting thing from a neuroscience perspective, is that we measured the neural activity. And when people were in teams, they started to get synchronized over time. So their brain activation looked like other people on their team. And over the course of the study, groups of four that were working together became more and more synchronized. And then people in the teams condition who were synchronized had the best performance on the task. And so they might have not even known it, but we could measure it in the lab and see that it predicted success on all these like critical tasks for group performance. And so these people we often say some groups, amazing teams are on the same wavelength. We literally measured whether they're on the same wavelength by measuring their electrical activity and brainwaves. And we found that this was truly related to their real world success on economic decisions and collective intelligence. We've also done this now in the classroom. So we have a paper, here's an example article on it. When people are on the same wavelength together, these students in this classroom over a whole semester, we found that they enjoyed working together and learned more, said they learned more in school. And we found that the teacher we worked with, we found that when he got them to discuss things collectively and got them on the same wavelength by like sharing stories, they were more likely to be synchronized than where they were just like kind of reading on their own or doing their own thing. And so teachers and leaders can use these strategies in theory to get people on the same wavelength. The other thing we said, and I'm on, I think this is my last slide. The other thing we found that was really cool is that you can get on the same wavelength with another individual. So we found that when people made eye contact or connected, even for just a few minutes before the class, at the start of the class, they were more likely to have the same wave, be on the same wavelength in terms of brain synchrony for the rest of the entire classroom session. And so those little, you know, these used to happen around the water cooler. And I think this is maybe one thing we've sacrificed a little bit of, by being virtual, although lots of benefits to being virtual. These are some of the benefits of like making those social connections with people. And then I have a great example of how teams do this. I won't play the whole thing, but this is the New Zealand rugby team, which is one of the best rugby teams, you know, over the last several decades in the world, arguably the best team ever. They have this ritual where they physically synchronize and chant together before each game. And people often think of this as a form of intimidation for the other team that they're playing, but it's also a tool and one that we used in our own study to get people synchronized on teams so that their brains became synchronized. We had them do this tapping ritual to the same music. And here they're chanting and dancing the haka dance, but this physical ritual is something that's used by militaries and all kinds of groups around the world, a form of collective behavior, a collective ritual to get people thinking and feeling on the same wavelength as one another. So this is just one place that it's used. They also have a lot of principles because it's not just key to be synchronized, but you wanna have norms that promote group success and get people to care about the groups. So I'll just share a couple key points and then this is, I think, we'll go to questions. One of their principles that they have, the New Zealand All Blacks rugby team, is called leave the jersey in a better place. And this is a model that all players have to embody. And what it means is that when you're part of this team, you're not just playing on the field right now and trying to be successful, that you're trying to make the organization and the culture here more successful. So even when you're gone, even when you're retired, that the team is better in the future. So they're always thinking about how to build the culture and make it better. And that everybody has a responsibility to be part of a team, not just a team now, but a franchise, an organization that started long before them and is going to continue long after them. And that they're basically passing the torch on, but they want to do it in a way that makes the organization better. The other principle they have, and one of my favorites, is they have what's called a no dickheads policy, which essentially means that a superstar is not put above the team. And you see this a lot in sports and it can often go wrong, that no one can be a jerk to everybody else. There's clearly some people are gonna be more talented or more successful in the field, but that doesn't give them the right to mistreat other people on the team or staff or coaches, that everybody has to care about the collective and that we all have a responsibility to treat each other well. And so these are some of like the keys to great teams isn't just getting a shared identity, but it's creating norms that reinforce the type of behavior you want and that nudge the team towards success. And that these norms, I think, and there's been a book written about it, are absolutely crucial to their winning streak. So they won 87% of their international matches, far better than any other team, at least up to the last time I checked. And so this is like part of thinking about when you have a great culture, it's not just building an identity, that's the first step, but there's leadership required to create norms that motivate people to care about the collective well-being. And so those are other themes that we talk about in our book, the value of norms and critically of leadership. And the key thing that we want to drive home, and I hope it sunk in a little bit today, is that as you develop a deeper understanding of what shared identity is, it allows us to move beyond thinking, you know, who am I, which is something most of us puzzle with most of our life, to asking who do I want to be and aspire to be someone better. But finally, also to thinking, who do we want to be? All of us are embedded within groups. We identify with groups. And we have a role, you know, no matter what our role is in the group that we're part of, whether we're a leader or just starting out, to try to change those social norms that I mentioned for the better, and to help change and create groups that we actually care about that are going to be successful, smart, and inclusive. So with that, I'll encourage people to go to the website at the bottom of this page. If they want to learn more, there's reviews of the book, summary of every chapter, summary of the book, some media coverage, and a link to our newsletter. We have a free weekly newsletter if you want to get smarter about groups. And with that, I'm happy to take questions.
Thank you so much, Jay. You know, now I think everyone understands why I'm such a big fan and have been for quite some time listening to your work and how you can connect social phenomena to neuroscience and make it all really clear and, you know, and accessible and also actionable. I think that's what the majority of the questions that I am looking at here are. And Nicole and Ellen, maybe we can get to a bigger screen to see Jay answering questions. Jay, I'm going to read out some of the questions that came in. You know, one, and I'm going to start with the last one from my colleague, Michael Diamond. The comment is around the environment in which it seems like some of the leaders in the media are trying to do the exact opposite, probably tapping into the same science, understanding what creates unity and kind of working deliberately against it. So the question to you is, from your, you know, neuroscience observations, et cetera, what are the antidotes to this type of deliberate divisiveness? And is it possible to resist? It seems like it's a very powerful tool that is being used with some unscrupulous purposes.
Yeah, I mean, Michael nails it. I think that we have a challenge when mass media and social media are set up this way. And I have an article I'm writing right now for the Washington Post on this, because we have data on this, where we've analyzed over 3 million messages online. And the things that are more likely to go viral on Twitter and Facebook are things that include moral emotions. And what you get when you use those is people will share it more. So there's a huge incentive to use that type of rhetoric. But when we analyze who's sharing it, it's really members only of people who are like-minded. So people in your own political bubble share it. The other thing that we found is that even more effective than that, in fact, the most effective thing we found for making messages go viral is dunking on an outgroup member. So saying something nasty about a member of the other political party, for every thing that you include that's nasty about them, it gets shared 67% more. And so the incentive structures of social media and the way that it monetizes our behavior by increasing engagement and the incentives for us as individuals to capture other people's attention, get likes, followers, retweets, is to do this increasingly. Even if we don't agree with it, it's incentivized. And so that's a problem. And it's not going to go away easily. Obviously, we had a whistleblower pointing this. You know, we wrote our piece and Facebook wrote a critique of our article when it came out this summer. And then the whistleblower is saying, you know, it's wrong. And then the whistleblower from Facebook came out last week and said basically everything we said was right. So they have a lot of internal data on this. I think they know that it's wrong or what's going on. So it's hard to push against these headwinds. And then there's, you know, lots of problems with polarized and hyperpartisan media. It's been devastating for the pandemic. because some people are not taking public health recommendations seriously. So I don't think that there's an easy solution to that, other than better leadership. And that means not just leadership at the highest levels, but community leadership, that organizations, members of communities, have to understand that these things are being done to divide and manipulate people for political purposes and for monetary purposes. And we just have to kind of figure out how to work through it in our own communities that we control and put pressure on people in power to do better and to change these things.
Yeah, I think Jay, when you figure out how to work against it and publish it, that's going to be, you know, that's what's going to save the world. And we're going to post those pictures of the planet. I think those are really powerful. And obviously in this context, there are a few questions here from Mona Lisa, from Roy Altman here, about the workplace, that our workplace, and you work with organizations, have been set up with such incentive systems that were really individually focused, just like in your lab, but at a huge scale, right? And I think we're gradually beginning to realize that that's not the optimal way to organize ourselves, at least in the workplace. So what are your observations around this coming to awareness that the systems, the current organizational systems we created, are counterproductive to the outcomes that we actually want to achieve?
Yeah, so thanks for those questions, Mona Lisa and Roy. And I'm glad you pointed out that these are like structural problems. A lot of these are, a lot of the questions are getting that we're embedded in these structures that reinforce the wrong things. So one of the things we talk about in our book is the need for collective incentives and collective rewards. And I find this in my own research is the same thing. So basically what you wanna do, and I think there's a value in incentivizing individuals. You wanna motivate people to be successful and contribute. And that helps avoid things like social loafing where people in a group would just slack off. And we've all been on a group project where we got stuck staying up late at night because like some other member of the group just like disappeared and didn't help. So you need to incentivize individuals to contribute, but what you should be incentivizing them is to contribute to group success. And so that means a mixed motive structure where there's some rewards, whether it's just social status or monetarily or for promotion, for being part of successful teams. And you see this in professional sports. They do this well, right? Superstars get bigger salaries, but the big thing that they all care about at the end of the season is getting a championship. And so once the playoffs come, people become radically less selfish because they care more about the championship and their legacy and those things. But they have a mixed reward structure that's critical to groups succeeding. And so organizations need to think about that. And I'll say that that's an even bigger issue while we've gone virtual. So there was a really powerful study that came out 2 weeks ago where they analyzed over 60,000 Microsoft employee emails. And they could see what happened after things went virtual. So Microsoft, full of smart people who can work from home, and they were just as successful getting their work done. And teams of people that were pretty tight-knit and met regularly were in contact with each other, you know, their weekly meeting and so forth. But what they found is the single biggest thing they found that eroded was connections across the organization. So connections between teams eroded, connections between divisions eroded and departments. And so we might think, well, maybe that's not a problem, each individual person's being as productive. But what the research suggests is those connections across divisions and across teams are often where most innovation occurs. So if you want to have innovation and breakthroughs, which is something a company like Microsoft cares a great deal about, those are probably going to be lost over time. So you're going to, it's not too much of a problem if you want to stay virtual, but leaders and organizations are going to have to think about structurally, how do they create and foster incentivized community at a moment where it's falling apart within their organizations in a way that they probably aren't detecting yet. And it's not measurable unless they're kind of quantifying these types of things. So I would say that to me would be something that we have to pay. This is on the horizon. And I think companies that get this right are going to be more successful in the long run. They'll have more innovations that pay off in big ways. They'll be able to retain employees because one of the, I noticed there's a big reshuffling. A lot of employees are leaving and a big amount of the rhetoric is about they don't like their salary or they're not happy. There's a new McKinsey analysis of it suggests one of the biggest things that people are leaving their job for right now is a lack of belonging. And so we've forgot to foster a sense of community so people can be successful doing their own thing. But a big reason that people stay in organizations and are motivated to stay engaged is because of connection. And if that's eroded, if we've forgotten to foster that and motivate it and incentivize it and cultivate it, then you're going to also lose your best people, because you usually don't lose your worst people. Usually it's your best people who leave.
Yeah, really excellent point. Another question that comes in here from a fellow academic, Emma Stenstrom, is asking you how you apply it in the classroom. You know, you have, again, the incentive systems oftentimes are set up in such a way, and remember grading on the curve, and there are all sorts of wrong incentives even in academia, but how does it work in the classroom?
Yeah, I mean, I teach a mix of tiny classes. So I just finished teaching, you know, 45 minutes ago. And, you know, I try to create a culture where students lead discussion. So I'm not always driving the conversation. And that I get their opinions and input every single class. And so I have them read things and then they get to share it. And it's also like a respect for different opinions. So even in my syllabus, which I share with all the students, I have a statement on inclusion of different backgrounds and perspectives in a way that you're not allowed to harass anybody. As long as it's germane to the classroom discussion, your perspective is relevant. And so I try to affirm that very explicitly in the structure of the syllabus. I've actually never had a problem. I also teach a class of 360 people. It's intro psych, which is the biggest class in the whole university. Or at least in psychology, I think it might be the whole university. And I love teaching that class. It's the greatest hits of psychology. But one of the things that it brings together is hugely diverse people. And so we talk about diversity. I talk about the challenges to lack of diversity in psychology research. I talk about the importance of diversity, and I have them express it. I have them all enter on the first day of class, all the different languages they speak. And so you can just see in the chat, you know, because it's been virtual, all the different people from all over the world, and they start to appreciate the diversity of people they're around. And so I try to do it in ways that open my mind and open other people's minds and embrace it and talk about it in ways that affirm how interesting and important it is.
Yeah, excellent, excellent point. Another student here, Jessica, is asking you about, again, this kind of disproportionate focus on revenue generating teams, et cetera, and undervalued a focus on that things that we care about, HR, for example, right? And these are the people who are really helping build that culture that generates results. So when you work with organizations, how do you advise, how do you manage, how do you communicate that message that, you know, building those teams, understanding the culture, creating different norms is actually a part of that external goal achievement that organizations care about?
Yeah, that's a great question. I've never had that one before, but my dad actually worked in car sales. And so I'll give you an example of how HR is really important and it messes up sales. So when he worked at a car dealership, if you were trying to sell a car, it was really important because if you sold, I think, 15 cars in a month, you got a $1,000 bonus. And the top salesperson for the month also got another bonus. So even if you didn't hit the 15, you got a separate bonus. And in the back of the manager's office, there was like a leaderboard of who was selling the most cars. Every time you'd sell a car for the month, you'd get a sticker. And they'd be keeping track, and that's how they determine bonuses at the end of each month. So huge incentive to just sell as many as you can. Now, here's where that goes wrong. My dad would say if he was selling a car and he had a client and they were showing on the floor, showing them cars, and another client would come in, let's say it's somebody who came in yesterday and spent 2 hours with him, and he was this close to, you know, selling that car with this person, you know, a green Ford truck. That person come in the next day, at that point, you know, that person's almost certainly gonna buy. But you have a client right now, so you can't drop them. And so the smart thing from an organization's perspective to maximize success and maximize profit would be to have my dad grab another salesperson and say, who wasn't doing anything, and say, this woman came in yesterday, she wants a green Ford truck. You can sell it at about $26,000. I worked them down, here's all the details. Close the deal and we'll split the commission. But I asked him if he would do that. And he said, no, I would never do that. Because now that salesperson is potentially moving ahead of him in all the key bonuses at the back of the manager's office. And so he would just tell the person who walked in, the customer, to come back another day. And they might never come back. They might go to another dealership and they're irritated because they want to come in and close the deal or something else happens. And so he said, I'd rather lose that sale than have it go to somebody else I'm competing against. Now, if you're the owner of that dealership or in HR, or whatever, that's a disaster for you because you haven't structured the incentives in a way that's effective, that maximizes everybody's success. It also would have been better for my dad to get a split commission with somebody than get no commission. And so you have to explain these structures to people, and that it's not just about individual sales, that you actually, a lot of times, even within sales, people are competing with each other internally that are a disaster for the organization. And so it's kind of explaining the logic and explaining the value of these things. Often it takes concrete examples. Sometimes it takes data. Other times you can measure it. So one of my favorite studies on team success was done by Google. It was called Project Aristotle. And they tried to measure across over 100 teams, which teams were flourishing and which teams were not. And Google crunches the numbers. They're like one of the best organizations in the world at analyzing data. They couldn't find any pattern. Didn't matter what personality types, whether people had a horizontal or a vertical leadership structure, whether they went out for drinks after work or just only met each other at work. None of that predicted. The only thing that predicted which teams outperformed others was psychological safety. Well, psychological safety is a construct that HR understands and constructs and creates. And so this is even in Google, where you have like all these very high level engineering types. Understanding the HR and the culture was the most essential thing to understanding which teams were successful. It wasn't who had the smartest people with the most coding experience. It was who had psychological safety. And by the way, psychological safety doesn't mean you can't talk to each other or criticize each other. It's the opposite. It means you can challenge any ideas. You can tell the boss you don't think their suggestion is going to work and why. You can come from a diverse background and say, I don't think this is going to work for this customer base. And here's why. You can challenge the status quo and you get invited back tomorrow and you're valued just as much, even if you criticize somebody or even if your idea doesn't work. That's what psychological safety is. And so people who understand this are going to create cultures and teams that are more successful. And the data just backs this up over and over again. Leaders who do this are going to be more successful. But a lot of times we're not measuring it in the right ways. But the moment you actually do the data analysis, with huge samples like Google did, you see that this is like the key singular thing that predicts team success. So I think that those are like the data and the examples. And also I would say, try to measure it in your own organization. Sales teams that have good cultures, or maybe that like are working within like the guidelines of what HR has created, are probably gonna be more successful if they're doing these things. And so that's probably a measurable thing.
That's terrific. Thank you so much, Jay. We recorded this. We're going to just take out that particular segment and put it on our website. This is really a great endorsement for what we do. We have a couple more questions in the pipeline, but I want to jump in with my own. And that, because I know your work probably a little closer, and I would love you to share with us what you found out about bias. I know you've done some work in bias, so obviously that's a big topic right now, and there's a lot of training going on, but tell us what's effective around managing for bias.
Yeah, so I'll try to weave this in with Luis's question about how long do these things last, and how do you create better long-term effects? So we have a whole chapter on bias and discrimination, and it starts by talking about implicit bias, which is what I started studying my very first year of grad school in 2003, I think. And I was looking at ways to intervene and reduce implicit bias, especially automatic racial bias. And so I found that if you put people on diverse teams, implicit bias starts to go away right away. We found it in the lab, we found it in multiple countries, found it at many different universities, we found it using neuroimaging, we found it using more implicit measures of behavior. Now, the problem with a lot of these interventions, and by the way, this has been replicated in many other labs around the world. There's this like 20 labs replicated, and that was one of the most single, what our lab found is one of the most single effective strategies for reducing bias is shared identities. I think it was the second most effective out of 20 interventions they tried. The problem is they came back a day later and it didn't work. Now here's why. Unless you reinstitute that intervention a day later, people are now back to thinking about the world in terms of things like race, right? Because you open the news or turn on the TV, and those are the types of identities that are driven in to you. And so as an organization, these things are only gonna work if you can sustain a shared sense of identity and purpose. The other thing that matters that we talk about in our book is that these things work better, shared identities, under a couple conditions. One is that your group is being successful. If the group's more successful, then people share that sense of identity, just like I showed you with the football example and basking in reflected glory. The other thing that seems to matter is the incentive structures you create. So if you reward groups for working together, it's going to be more effective. And you're going to have a sustained way of impairing that bias. Now, the barrier in a lot of organizations and what keeps bias going is often structural and institutional. And so bias gets reaffirmed through all kinds of aspects of the structures that we're embedded in. So if you want to talk about racial bias, you're not really going to get rid of that in society until you get rid of racial segregation, which has been around in this country for hundreds of years. And it happens, you can measure it at the county and neighborhood level. You're not really going to get rid of it until you get like rid of racial inequality and economics and access to health and things like that, because people are going to go back to the real world and they're faced with that. And so organizations are essentially left living in a world that has those types of cleavages. It's going to have to figure out how to eradicate them in the organization. And I will say this, because this is the future, and we talk about this, which is, I also have some papers on algorithmic bias. And so algorithms, which is more and more organizations are using them for hiring and stuff like that, can actually reduce bias. There's studies showing it can, because you're not, you know, there's lots of discrimination that happens in hiring, for example. And if you use algorithms that are judging people on their accomplishments, you're going to get rid of some of the effects of stereotypes and racial bias and implicit bias that people doing the hiring and promoting have. But if your algorithms are trained on data sets that are looking for certain types of characteristics that predict maybe, let's say, promotion in an organization, let's say you're giving it all the organizational leaders from 1950 to 1970, well, you're just going to end up promoting a lot of guys named John, because that's the only people who had access and opportunities to the education and organizational success from 1950 to 1970. So you have to be very mindful, not only of the algorithm you're using, but what it's trained on, the data it's trained on, because if you just enter in a bunch of data that's full of historic discrimination, it's just going to reify it and reinstitute it. And it's actually, I would argue, be even worse, because people are going to think, oh, it's just math, it's impartial, and therefore it's unbiased. Well, it's not unbiased if you fed in biased data sets to train up the machine learning algorithm. So you have to think very carefully. I use an extreme example, but it happens in all kinds of subtle ways with modern algorithms. So important, really important to think about if you're gonna fight against divisiveness. It's shared identities, but also understanding the structure and systems you're dealing with.
So Jay, just the final one before we conclude. What are you working on now? We know you are writing that article for the Washington Post, and I hope that you do more of those, including opinion pages and op-eds, right? That we need to hear scientists stepping in and explaining what's going on, because education is one of the ways we're going to fight against the biases that exist. But what are you working on, and what should we, we obviously are all going to sign up for your newsletter. But just share with us the highlights.
Okay, I'll share you three highlights. So one is a paper I just had accepted for publication yesterday. I tried to apply these principles to doing a project. And so I just published a paper with 260 authors from around the world, where we collected roughly 60,000 participants during the start of the pandemic. And we tried to predict what predicts people actually following public health guidelines all over the world. So we had data from 67 countries. And what we found is one of the single biggest predictors was national identity. So national identity gets a bad rap, but it turns out there's two parts of national identity. There's like pride in your country and caring about the success of your country. And if you're fighting a pandemic at the national level, you have to trust leaders, hope they're working in your best interest. And so countries that did that well, so my favorite example is the Prime Minister of New Zealand, Jacinda Ardern. She created a sense of shared identity and purpose, and they were by far the most successful in reopening the country and economy early, but also dramatically reducing the deaths and mortality and illness in their country. So we have that data coming out. And then the other stuff that we're doing, one of the writing in for the popular press, we have an article coming out, I think it's in the C-suite leadership magazine in the Wall Street Journal, coming out in a few weeks on groupthink and avoiding groupthink. So you can look for that. And then we also have a piece that we are working on for The Guardian. So we also have a UK audience and a UK publisher, talking about polarization and how you can deal with that at an interpersonal level. So I study also polarization in organizations and groups and politically. And it's true, polarization is getting much worse. But it's also true that it's worse in our minds than it is in reality. So there's what's called false polarization. And what it means is that you think people from other parties actually disagree with you more than they actually do. And that fosters even more conflict. And so it turns out when you correct people's stereotypes about other groups, that it makes them more open-minded to engaging with those groups and finding common ground. And so we write about that research. We have that research in our book, but we also have it coming out in a piece in The Guardian. So you can look for that.
Fantastic. I think this is definitely something we need to pay attention to and reaffirm our collective identity, at least at NYU, right, Jay? that's great. Thank you so much. I also just wrote a little review of your book that I will be posting as well on LinkedIn and on Amazon and a few other places. Thank you. Thank you, everyone who came here on Friday afternoon. And Nicole, I think we have the final slide, right, to show. All right. So these are the ways you can connect with Jay. As you can see, he's very accessible really lots of information on all of these sites. And also check out his lab and what he's doing here at NYU. And then our next book event is coming on November 11th. It will be Data-Driven Organizational Design, and December 3rd, Beyond Collaborative Overload with Rob Cross. So thank you all very much. Jay, have a wonderful weekend. We are going to be reading your book this weekend, and we will see you all very soon. Thank you. Enjoy your weekend. Bye-bye.